and our audience and our internet connections and around the world. And today I'm going to be talking to you about God's way of leading. God leads us, and He gives us word on that in the Bible. And I'm going to read you a scripture before we get into our message. It comes out of Romans 6, and it says, "Knowing this, that Christ, being raised from the dead, dieth no more. Death hath no more dominion over Him. For in that He died unto sin once, but in that He liveth unto God." Would you say liveth unto God? Why do you do what you do? Motivation is everything. If you're doing something for a different motivation, you know that it's not God. But when God has called you, He's called you according to His purpose, not yours and His name. It's called according to His purpose. God made you. Young men and women, God made you. He made you for His purpose. You have to discover what that purpose is. God is here today. He's here. I know He's here. He's in me. I pray that He's in you. And I ask God that He would speak to you before this. And if you have the Holy Spirit in you, I guarantee you the Holy Spirit will ignite something inside of you that lets you know that He is here. And He's here now. But it goes on to say, "For in that He died unto sin once, but in that He liveth unto God." He liveth unto God. Christ liveth unto God. Jesus Christ is the CEO of heaven. He's the head of the church. He's the one that sets the example for all of us to follow. There is no other example but Jesus Christ. When we begin to see that, we begin to follow Him, not man, not denomination, not Christology. Christ is not Christology. That's a study of who Christ is. Christ is Christ. He doesn't change. But He says here in the scripture, in the sixth chapter of Romans, He says, "Likewise, reckon ye yourself." See, this is the issue. If Christ set an example, what you're supposed to do is follow the example. If the CEO tells you how to live, you live like He lived. And so He says, "Likewise, reckon ye yourselves also dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it and the lust or the desires thereof. Neither yield ye your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness unto God. For sin shall not," say shall not, "sin shall not have dominion," that is, control or power or direction over you. "For ye are not under the law, but under grace." The only way that sin could have power over you is if you're under the law. I am under a law, but it's not that one. I'm under the law of grace and of love of Jesus Christ. And that says to me, I've been set free from the law of sin and death. "What then? Shall we sin because we're no longer under the law, but under grace? God forbid. Know ye not that to whom ye yield yourselves servants to obey, His servants ye are." Think about that. Whether of sin unto death or unto obedience unto righteousness. Say obedience unto righteousness. Do you know that obedience is what righteousness is? It's obedience unto the Lord. What His Word says, it declared, and it declared once for all. I know some of you go out to the Facebook and you'll see things that I put out there, and some people will come back and they'll put smileys, and some people will put "aw," and, you know, or "whoa," or and that kind of stuff. Some people will put tears. Some people put "like," and some people put "love." I try not to look at all those things because I don't know what they're responding to or how they're responding. You know, but I put out this week, if you want to hear a personal word from God, if you want to hear the voice of God, how many of you have ever heard voices? I'll see you Monday through Friday, 8 a.m. till 5 p.m. in the counseling center. No, the issue is that God does have a voice. But I said, you know, read the Bible out loud. You want to hear the voice of God? Read the Bible out loud. That's His voice. He gave us a word that does not change, one that will be the foundations for everything we stand on until we leave this earth and afterwards. It will judge all men, and all men will be either found faithful or guilty based on that word. People always, I want to tell you something. God's used me in the word of prophecy many times. And there have been people say, I don't know if that's it doesn't come to pass. Look, you just like the Old Testament people saying to the prophets they didn't know if he was a prophet or not. They killed him because it didn't come to pass in their lifetime. Let me tell you something about the word of God. It comes to pass, every word of it will come to pass, and it will not come to pass. The Bible is the word of prophecy. It is the spirit of prophecy. What does prophecy mean? It tells you where you're at. It's a device that cuts between spirit and flesh. You know, it divides. It will show you. How many of you have ever read the Bible and it showed you something that you needed to repent of? How many of you ever read the Bible? If you read it, it'll begin to show you things about yourself that will not change. God in His person, though, made sure that when the Lord Jesus came, that He would not be relying on Himself, but He would have to rely on the Father even as we do. Listen to me. God gave me a dream this week. I won't be speaking about it today except to mention it. They gave me a dream, and it was about power. How many of you think you're powerful? How many of you know you're not? You know, the issue of power comes, there is no power but of God. So anything that comes through you came from Him. If you think you're powerful and you don't have Him, you're trying to do something, operate in yourself, you're only fooled. The issue is you have no power. How many of you have power over sin? Zero of you. How many of you can, through Christ, have power over sin? All of us. The issue is a submission issue. Listen, there is no greater message that I could preach to you than how God leads us and the submission that is required for you to be able to rise up over the adversary. Listen, when God says to us that the gates of hell will not be able to prevail against His church, what does He mean? The gates of hell will not prevail against you and me. There is no power greater than the power of God. He goes again to say to us that Jesus told us, greater is He that is what? In you than is in the world. The issue is that we have to believe what He said. Don't become somebody that is not a believer. If we have the power of God dwelling in us, then we have that power of belief that can cause us to rise up above our enemy. He gave us power over how many people? None. How many enemies? All. The issue of all of our enemies are under our feet also. If they're an enemy of us and we're on God's side, they're an enemy to God. And if God's on your side, He tells you who can be against you. He tells you also that those enemies that rise up against you, He says you can actually tell that word that comes out of them and that kind of thing, you're condemned. You have power to condemn words that are less than what Jesus has said about you. If that happens, what does He say? They might rise up against you, but He says that He'll rise up against them. Do you understand what He's saying? God is going to be God till the very end of our life and even beyond our lives. So He goes on to tell us, what then shall we sin because we're not under the law but under grace? God forbid. Know ye not that to whom you yield yourselves servants to obey, Do you obey the adversary or do you obey the Lord Jesus? His servant ye are to whom you obey, whether to sin unto death or obedience unto righteousness. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that your words are true no matter who tries to prove them otherwise. That, Lord God, your word has in it power, true power, the anointing of God, the power that breaks yokes, the power that saves souls. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that today your word is in this place. Your word is in me. Your word is in many of those that are here. And, Father, I pray that you have given them ears to hear what is about to be preached, what is about to be said. Lord, preach through me. You know I can do nothing without you. I ask you for your anointing now. In the name of Jesus Christ, I ask you to rise up in this place and cause our hearts and lift it up. And Heavenly Father, our eyes lifted upon you. And Heavenly Father, our ears open to what you have to say. Father, for our young people, Lord God, I pray that, Lord, today will be a changing day in their hearts and minds. I ask you, Lord, for our old people, Heavenly Father, that their hearts would be renewed and their minds be renewed. Father, in Jesus' mighty name, may it be so. And, Lord, may you be glorified forever. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. All right. I'm going to take my coat off here, if y'all don't mind. It's getting warm up here in front of all these lights. You know, you're in the spotlight when you're on camera and that kind of thing. So, and the camera is requires a light to operate just as you do. How many of you know that when you don't have lights, you can stumble? How many of you have ever stumped your toe? How many of you glorified God when you did? I have an idea that some of that wasn't glorifying God. Anyway, so let's go on. We're going to be talking about how God leads. Would you like to know how God leads you? We're going to talk a little bit about how God leads us now. In Psalms chapter 119, verse 11, it says, "Thy word have I hid," this is David, "Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee." Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee. Now, I don't know what your habits and routines with the Lord are, but I mean, every bathroom in my house has a promises book in it, all the promises of God for your every need. The Bible says, keep his promises before our eyes, our frontlets, so that we don't forget those things. You know, it's easy for you to forget, especially when you're going through, how many of you are going through a difficulty and you wanted a word from God? Listen, he's already given you one, so he's asking you to consider what he's already said. The Holy Spirit can remind you of those things only if you put it there in your heart so that he can. You have to have that word in your heart. But when God deals with you, what he's going to do is he's going to pull those things you've already put in your heart. Putting your heart and your head are two different things. Put it in your heart is you take it personal. The Word of God is not an impersonal book for people who want to be intellectuals about God. The Word of God is the Word of God to you as an individual. Well, it was to all the people that ever existed, right? No, it's to them that believe. And when we accept the Word of God as the Word of God, it's His Word that does not change and it is forever settled and it is to you personal. God gives his word. It is a personal word. All of you that want another word, listen, you're going to listen to somebody that tells you something that is not in the Word of God. I promise you, that's a lesser word. If you want to hear what God has to say, know what he said in his word. It will not change and will judge mankind. Amen? Okay, listen. So, the second thing we want to look at here is how he deals with you. Anybody know what this word means? Intuition. Intuition is not, I hope he says something to me. Intuition is not you setting your mind on something and praying that God will bring that about. When you're asking God to show you his pathway, to lead you in paths of righteousness for his name's sake, here's what intuition is. How many of you have ever been in a conversation with somebody and all of a sudden You said something without thought, without forethought. It came into your mind, your spirit, and all of a sudden you're saying something, you're going, wow, where'd that come from? That's intuition. It's God giving to you something that is beyond the scope of you sitting around trying to reason or figure it out. That's what intuition is. Excuse me. The ability to understand something immediately. Immediately. In other words, you didn't have time to think it out. How many of you have ever tried to think God out? That doesn't work, does it? God wants to speak to you, and if you're having to figure out, is this God? Probably not. The issue of when God speaks, it came immediately. It came without you thinking about it. It was something greater than your wisdom. It was greater than your intellect. It was greater than your understanding. It was great. It was God. It was good. It came from the Lord. And it came because it was in season, and it was the understanding that you were coming to Him, you were doing something on His behalf, and you were expecting Him to show up and work with you. When the disciples, when Jesus had left here, and the disciples were left, the Bible says that they went out and they preached everywhere to everyone. Now, everybody in this room is a preacher. Okay, I didn't say pastor, I didn't say evangelist. Everybody in this room is a preacher. That means a proclaimer of truth. And when you go out, your commission from the Lord is to preach good news to everyone, everywhere around the world. He called them creatures. Now, you kids don't look at each other and say, I thought you were a creature. Okay. My daughter used to say that to one of our evangelist friends every time he'd come. His name was Henley, Preacher Henley, and she called him Creature Henley every time he came in. And I thought, oh, God, I hope he isn't offended, you know. So anyway, but we're to preach to every creature on the earth, everyone. Doesn't matter who they are. They ought to hear out of us some sort of a word that lets them know that God dwells in us. See, God, when you were born again, God saved you for the purposes, His purposes. His purpose was manifest, and it was spoken to us. It was that we should go out and we should proclaim Him to everyone. It wasn't for us to sit back and let the world overcome. God sent His church into the world, His word into the world, to go into His church so that the world would be changed by the light that was in the church, not the other way around. And I promise you, the world's trying to overcome, and it's trying to invade the darkness, trying to invade the light. But I want to tell you what I've learned about light. Light is not going to be invaded by darkness. You can't shut light out. Not only that, I found out that light has in it sound waves. Do you know that God is light, and the Bible tells us that out of that come sound waves, and the Word can come through sound waves? And that's the reason that they're trying to look into light as a way of transmitting Word now. You know, one of these days you're going to have a light drive on your computers, and the light will actually have a sound that can come through it, and it can actually speak to you. Think about that. It's a great thing. Imagine this for a moment, that God's letting the church catch up with Him. He said, follow me. He's letting you catch up. Okay. So anyway, intuition is the ability to understand something immediately without the need for conscious reasoning. We shall allow our intuition to guide us. Amen. So when you wonder, what should I do? It's imperative. That means you ought to know that it's very important that you get to a place that you allow the Holy Spirit to speak God's word to you through you. He doesn't do it with you saying, maybe it's this or maybe it's that. No, it will automatically show up in your intuition, and you will know that it was Him. God speaks through your intuition. Okay, He created your soul. Your soul has in it an organ, the center of your brain, the cerebrum, colossum, has in it the ability to will to do right and the will to do wrong. Did y'all know you had an organ in your head that does that? The ability to do right or the ability to do wrong. How many of you struggle with the ability to do right? Okay. But the Bible tells us that when this has been renewed, then that Spirit of God dwells in you. That's the reason David said, I want us to be able to have that word in us that we will not sin against you. But he hid not the power to do what he was asking. Now, New Testament, the Holy Spirit came. That changed the picture of all things. Okay? Hebrews chapter 5, verse 14 says this, But strong meat, that means the Word of God, the deep things of God, belongeth to them that are of full age. How many of you were just happy to get saved? How many of you thought that was it? You see, for strong meat, the deep things of God, belong to them that are of full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil. Your senses are exercised when you're going through something. If you go to the Word of God, if He gives you something in your intuition, you go and you find out that's true. Now, I want to tell you something. My heart does all kinds of crazy things. Sheila will tell you, there are times at night my heart rate, I've got one of those watches, it'll tell you, it's got a little EKG on it, and it'll tell you what your heart rate is at all hours. And sometimes during the night, my heart will run up to 127, 130 beats a minute. It's like I'm out running a race. And that's not a good thing, by the way. All of you that know anything about medicine know that that's not a good thing. When you're laying on your bed, you ought to be at rest, right? But I'm burning energy at night when I'm laying on the bed, and I'm dead asleep, and all of a sudden I wake up because my heart is running at racing speeds. See, I reach over and touch my wife and say, can you pray with me, and that kind of thing. Please, Lord, cause my heart to come back into normal sinus rhythm. And she'll pray for me, you know, and she doesn't get, you know, Sheila's got a childlike faith, and she can pray for people and they'll be healed. It's just that way. And God gave her an anointing for that. But I know that, so I'm going to wake her up at night and make her upset, you know, because she's right in the middle of dead sleep, and all of a sudden she's finding herself in a difficulty, you know, because her husband's waking her up at 3 o'clock in the morning saying, can you pray for me? You know, my heart's running away. She knows if I tap her now, that's what's going on. And she'll reach over and she'll touch me. And in her sleep, you know, in a sleepy condition, she will pray, Lord, touch his heart. Restore it. Give him peace and rest. And it comes back. When you have the Word of God in you, then when you start praying, you're not talking to walls. You're not talking to people. You're talking to the Lord. And when she calls on the Lord hears. It's amazing that He can hear you at 3 o'clock in the morning. No matter what time you call on Him, He's there for you. But listen, there are things in the Word deeper than your understanding that can only be known by what God will show you about it. There are things I want to preach to you so many times. I said this to David a week or so ago, and I said, you know, David, I can talk to you about this stuff. I hope you can get it. But there are things the Lord's shown to me that are so much, much deeper than what I can even preach to people, because I can't just preach everything that God says to me, because there will be people going, oh, they're a cult. No, we're not a cult. Darling, if you know that God will reveal to you the hidden thing, He gives to you hidden treasures, that He'll show you things that you know not of. He'll show you things that you have never even read about. Or if you did read it, you didn't understand it until He opened the eyes of your understanding. You didn't understand what He was saying. Does that make sense to you? That God is a king, and then he holds those things until somebody actually does desire the deeper things of God. Listen, it's not enough for me to be saved. I had a revelation of people going to hell. It's not enough for me to be saved. I have to go now and have to reach people around the world, because it's not enough for me and my house to be saved. I can live, me and my house, for the Lord. We'll serve Him. But the issue is that I have to reach other people for Him because of what He has shown me and the deep things of God. And then He shows me things. Like the light the other day, and that kind of thing. And then the thing about power. No man has power. All power is of God. Nobody has power except of God. So the only way you can walk in the power of God and overcome the adversary is through God. You don't have power. You have authority, and there's a difference between authority and power. God can tell you, you have authority to do this, but unless you are submitted to Him, there's no power to accomplish it. Y'all didn't get that, did you? You can do nothing, Jesus said, without Him. John 15. So, God lets people that are full age be able to discern, because they've had their senses, exercised. What does exercise mean? It's the thing that they make you do at school, right, girls and boys? Make you. You got to go exercise. Y'all like to exercise? Oh, no. You like to run a mile or so in the at track? You do?
We did, but pretty much all they did was, it's really, frankly, really boring now, because all they do is, here's the gym. Do whatever you want. You can't go outside. And, one day they're like, okay, you run around the track one time. That's the end of the day. So I was like, oh, that's boring.
that's what I, about people with NASCAR. They're just going around and around in circles, right? And there's nothing new unless somebody wrecks and kills themselves. You're really just going to be bored to death, right? Those kind of things. And you know what? Christianity is no different if you're just going around and around in circles. But there, He wants to get you off that track and on another track. He has a pathway that not a lot of people are on. But God wants your senses to be exercised. That's to be aware of when something's happening that is not right. How many of you have ever been tempted to sin? Every day. Okay? When that comes, the Bible tells me that you're not under the dominion or the power of that temptation. You're saying, I can't help myself. Yes, you can. See, you're lying to yourself, because you have heard that lie from the devil, and the devil continues to cause you to do the same thing over and over. You keep giving in, because you become his servant that way, and you're yielding yourself to him, and so he begins to have dominion over you. That's his hope always. But let me say this to you. The moment that you have the temptation to sin, here's what God asks of you, that you submit to God. That is, God, that's not you. That's not you. That's not something you would have me to do. You don't want me to be enslaved and not free. You came that I might be free. And so you want me to yield to you. So I'm yielding myself to you. Now, you can turn around with the fullness of God's power. And let me say this to you. The very power that raised Christ from the dead, if you're born again and have His Holy Spirit, the very Christ that raised Him from the dead dwells inside of you. The very power of God dwells inside of you. And so you have to rely on God, and you, when you yield to Him, yield to God, that is called obedience. You're obeying God, not man, not Satan, not temptation. You're not yielding to the flesh. You're yielding to God. When you yield to God, and you turn around, you're not turning around the same as when you submitted to God. You're turning around in the fullness of his power. Now, the adversary is subject, listen to me, the adversary that lied to you and brought something that was going to play into your weaknesses, the adversary that did that to you is the adversary that is subject to Jesus because he was defeated and put under Jesus' feet. Jesus made him an open spectacle, shame, and put him down by what he did on the cross. You know, when God the Father says do something and you obey him, you are defeating the enemy. The enemy has zero power over God. But your obedience in Christ brings the power of Christ through you to defeat your adversary. Do you understand what that means? That when you say no to the sin, you say yes to God. And when you do say yes to God, you're having your senses exercised at that point. And with that, you know the difference between good and evil. And when you say no to the evil, you're saying yes. You can't just say no. You have to say yes to God, and you say yes to God so that the adversary cannot control you. Because he will have dominion over you when you yield to that temptation. God does not put us in bondage to sin. And so knowing that he doesn't do that means that we ourselves can be set free. And when we submit, and all the power of God, listen to me now. I know this is boring. Some of you don't know what I'm talking about. But the issue of all that God has given to us is at our disposal through Christ Jesus. All of it is at our disposal through Christ Jesus. Now, God leads us by that power. When we submit to him, we're saying, you above my wishes. Now, how does that come about? Let's look at some things, okay? As Christians, we should learn to understand God's way of leading as well as the relationship between man's will and God's will. Is God taking your will away from you because you're a Christian? The answer is no. How many of you know that you have a will and that your will, he gave you freedom over that will? You have a power to choose who you will serve. That's will. If you choose to serve God, then the power of God is manifest in you to overcome the adversary that brings lust, deceit, lying. You know, the devil never tells you the truth. If he tells you, you know, this is going to be fun, this is going to, the one more time won't hurt, and all that kind of stuff. All of you've heard this kind of junk. The adversary, when he's saying those things to you, is lying. He cannot tell the truth. Okay, listen now. What I'm talking to you about is what you don't need. So, we must believe and realize that a believer's submission to God should be unconditional, right? If God wants you to, you know, resist an adversary, he also wants you to submit to him so you can have the power to actually turn around. Not, oh, I don't want to do this again. No, no, no. You have to submit to God for the power to work through you to overcome what the adversary is throwing at you. He knows your weaknesses. Let me throw something else at you. Only when you realize your ineffectiveness against the devil, only when you realize your own weaknesses, only then when you turn to God in your weakness can he be made strong. Do you know what that means? Only then can the power of God work through you to overcome all those things that the adversary is throwing at you. Let me say it again. When you see the adversary throwing something of a temptation at you, when you know that that's your weakness, that's where you've failed, and the adversary, you know the only one that's really pointing that out to you is the adversary. But God tells you in your weakness, wherever your weakness is, that's the ground zero where God is going to come and be your strength. And when you accept that God is going to be the power against that temptation, then God comes to be the power in you over that temptation. God will break the yoke of bondage off of you and take away the temptation. He will actually, you know, I know how this works because he's done that through me for years and years and years. Anything that showed up that was a weakness, God has exercised himself or exercised me to know the difference between the good and evil. And then in me, he has caused his power to rise up in my weakness and break the yoke of bondage off of me. So the adversary goes, what does he say about this in James? When you submit to God and resist the devil, he will flee from you. Why does he flee? Because he saw that you gave God right place in your heart. And when he saw that, he knew that he was not a power against the power you were submitted to. It's not magic. It's a choice. Amen? Everybody in this room has to deal with those kind of issues. So anyway, let me go on. Because I can, boy, you know I could get long-winded with you, and I don't want to do that. Man's will and God's will, okay? Moreover, when a believer's spiritual life has reached a climax. Now, does that word ring to adults different than what it should be? When you have reached the point, the highest point, in your spiritual believing, his will should be one with your will. You should not be saying, well, I have a choice here. No, it's not that you don't have a choice anymore, you see. This doesn't mean that a believer no longer has his own will. The faculty of his will still exists, but the natural temperament is gone. When God breaks through and becomes your victorious Christ, the one that causes you to be an overcomer, what is an overcomer? Not somebody submitting to the same thing over and over. It's somebody that through those senses has known that that's the area of weakness, and when that weakness starts showing up, they begin to pray and ask God to help them to overcome, and then they submit to God, and the power of God through them begins to show up in such a way as to break the desire, that natural temperament, and it does not fulfill the will of the adversary. It fulfills the will of God. Now, let's put it in other words for you. Okay? You see, it tells us that if we walk in the Spirit, we shall not fulfill the deeds of the flesh. What does that mean? If we walk in the Spirit, we will not fulfill the deeds of the flesh. God's power, if we're walking with him, in concourse with him, equal to in all ways, because whatever power that is now yours. That same power is the power of life, and the power of death has no power over that. So when that power is walking with you and you're in oneness with him, say, as a man will, when he begins to walk with God and he walks with him, his natural temperament is laid aside. It's not magic. It requires a choice. I'm not going to do that. How many of you have said that and still failed? There is an element that's missing. The submission to God that you know that is not pleasing to God, so you want to please God above the issue of your flesh or against the issues of all that goes on with man. Now, I want to tell you how the victory works. The victory is in that we know that God is for us, and God would not have us doing those things because it takes us, it separates us from him. When you sin, you're messing with things you don't even know that you're messing with. You're separating yourself by a choice from the life of God. Okay? When you choose God, you choose life. When you choose something else, you're choosing something that is not God. Right? God wants you to choose him. And when you do, you have life, and life more abundantly. You want to be blessed by God, but you don't want to do what he says. That doesn't work, right? You've ever done that? God bless me, bless me, bless me. God is the blessing if you hadn't got that yet. And where he is, all things are. and whatever he has is yours. The issue of being blessed is that he is on your side. And more than that, now you are on his side, right? I don't mean to bore you. I want to open up some doors and windows for you here. So, if God's willing to overcome your natural temperament when you submit to him and you yield to him, he doesn't leave you in that lurch where you're going, well, what do I do now? No, he empowers you and he breaks a yoke off of you. In other words, what has held you in bondage can no longer hold you in bondage, because bondage is dominion. That's an issue of the adversary keeping you under the weightiness of sin and under the enslavement that goes with him. But see, all of that comes because you're guilty of breaking the law. But now we're under grace. And God pours out his grace to those that come into his presence. And he says he gives mercy to them and grace in their time of need. And grace is the power of God that comes into somebody non-deserving of what he's giving to them. And he gives to them a power to overcome their temperament, their sin, their weaknesses. In my weakness, now am I made strong. Paul even put it this way. You know, I'm glad. I'm going to rejoice now in my weakness. I'm going to rejoice in my weakness. Because only when I rejoice in my weakness does that show the Lord that I need him. And I'm rejoicing that he's coming, and he will come and be poured out on me in that time like at no other time. Only in my weak times. God is giving people in their weakness an opportunity for a choice. And he does it every day. Every one of us, right? Okay? So, I need to go on. God still needs the faculty of man's will to work with him for the accomplishment of his will. In other words, he doesn't want you to be a robot, so you get a choice in the matter. Okay? Why doesn't he just take the choice away and just do it, you know, and See, free will requires that you choose who you will serve. You get to choose that. It's not men that do that. In a sense, separated from that, God shows up. It's like, you know how it is. You've seen those commercials, the devil on this shoulder and the Lord or the angel on this shoulder, and they're both talking to you, and you're going, you know, which one am I going to choose? You know how most people choose. But when you understand that God wants to give you power over the devil and that you become an overcomer through that, and with that, by the way, there is a crown of life laid up for those that do that. And one of these days I'll preach on crowns for you. But anyway, God wants your faculty to choose him. He doesn't want you to be a robot made to do something. He wants, and listen, that for all of you that have been legalists in the past, you know, I know how it is. I've had that problem too, you know, thank God that I'm free. Nevertheless, I want you to hear me, that when you have the freedom to choose, then your choice is not robotic. It's not something mechanical. It's you saying, it's your spirit saying, God, I'm not doing this because I have to. I'm doing this because I want to. There's a difference. I want to go to church on Sunday. I don't have to. I get a choice. And that's the issue. I'm free. You know, I can pick up and next week I can be in a trawler in Florida. I have that choice, but because I love the Lord, who called me has already placed a gift inside of me that I have to use for his purpose. So anyway, let's go on. When we look at the pattern of the Lord Jesus, we can see that a person who is one with God still has the capability of his own will. Is that right? Can y'all do dastardly things that God would not approve of? Okay. Okay. So, you know, we still have the capability of our will. But Jesus sets the example for us, and let's look at some scripture here for that. This was Jesus just hours before his own crucifixion. His disciples were not understanding. Well, we're just getting started. I mean, things are good. For heaven's sake, you just preached 5,000 last week now. And right at the end of this, it says, I do not seek my own will, but the will of him who sent me. How many of you ask God to have his will, his way? You ever prayed that? Lord, your will be done. Let's go and let's do another one. See, in John 6:38, he repeats himself. I'm not here to do my will, but the will of him who sent me. Who sent you? We'll get there in a minute. You see, Jesus says, as the Father hath sent me, so send I you. Have you been sent? When the Lord opens his mouth, he is declaring something to an earth, to an environment, to the people around him, to the entities of the ages, and even to the devil and hell itself. But remember, the gates of hell will not prevail. If you are submitted to God and you continue steadfast, unmovable to the end, you're not only going to be saved, but you're going to be given the power to rule and reign with the Lord in the 1,000 years to come after this life is over. One more, Luke 22:42, and it says, yet not my will, but yours be done. He was in the Garden of Gethsemane where he was facing the beatings and the horrible pain and all of that, and he wanted not to have. How many of you not wanted to go through something and you knew that it was God's will and you were having to go through that? There have been a lot of that for me. But here we can see that the Lord Jesus is one with the Father, and his own will was there besides the Father's will. In the garden, he knew it was going to be a painful event. He knew exactly why the Father had sent him. He went off every day to pray that he could find the Father's will so that he could do those things that God sent him here for. Listen, this isn't a Sunday morning thing that I'm talking to you about. This is a life that was sent by God, for his purpose. That's you. He made everything that is. And he called you according to his purpose. But he chooses those who submit. Amen? Now listen. When he did this, he had that will. He still had it with him. Nevertheless, he said, Father, not my will be done, but yours. So these verses do not say that he does not have his will. Rather, that they say that he did not seek to perform or accomplish his own will. If God is higher than us, why are we leaning on our understanding? If God is higher than us and knows better than we do, why do we do what we do? We all have weak spots, right? They know not what they do. Thank you. Okay. Therefore, whoever is really one with God should not eliminate the function of his will. Rather, he should put his will on the side of God's will. In other words, choose to be on God's side. Genuine leading does not mean that the believer should obey God like a machine, as I've said before. Rather, it means the believer should actively carry out God's will. Actively means it's not passive. I'm going to talk to you about that in just a second. God does not want the believer to follow him blindly. He wants the believer to use the whole being sensibly to do his will. In other words, he wants you to understand what he's doing with you. It's not just do it. I've heard people in times past, you don't have to understand anything. No, you're not going to do anything unless you understand it. He created that in you. Understand that he created understanding. He opens the eyes of your understanding, and he does that so that you can be on his side. You can't be on the side of somebody you can't agree with. And until he reveals to you what he's doing, you're not going to be on his side. And I'm going to talk about that in a minute, too. Magic Jesus. Y'all know about this? Jesus is going to do it for me. No, see, he didn't call you to think that he was just going to do it for you. He's going to do it through you. Lazy ones like to see God acting for them while they passively follow. But God does not want believers to be lazy. God wants believers to be vigorously prepare their members and actively obey after they have spent the time to examine and understand God's will. There are going to be times you don't yet have the understanding when you're going through something. So you don't do anything until you do. Why would you do something? You know, I see this, and a lot of young Christians, you know, and even some young pastors want to run with the word before they have it exercised in them. What I'm talking about is an exercise. When you have had God work in you, through you, by you, then you know that when you're yielding to him, there isn't anything higher, nobler than anything else that you can give yourself to. There's no other purpose greater than that. Who do we work for? We work for him. Doesn't matter what you do for a living, you work for the Lord. No matter where he lets you gives you the power to obtain wealth, you work for the Lord. You are, if you're on the job, you know, you're supposed to be a witness of him to them, right? Every one of them. And you'll hear them. You know, y'all know how it is. On your job, there are people that want to come in, and all they want to do is whine and complain about where they're at and all the stuff that's going on around them and all that kind of thing. My wife, my children, my job, my employer, but wait a minute. All those things are subject to where we really rule. Okay? Absolutely. If a believer desires to obey God, he must go through these steps. Now, I'm going to give you some steps. First, he must resolve to obey God's will. And it says this in John 17:17. If anyone is willing to do his will, God's will, he will know, this is Jesus speaking now, he will know whether the teaching is of God or whether I speak on my own accord and by my own authority. He was standing with religious people when he said it. They were saying, well, that's just your opinion. Have y'all ever heard anybody say that? That's just your opinion? Could you imagine somebody saying that to Jesus? No. You know, but they did. That's craziness. The second rule here is he must receive the revelation concerning God's will through his intuition. We talked about intuition a while ago. God immediately shows you something. You've had that eureka moment. God's given you eyes to see and ears to hear. And all of a sudden, he's put his will in your intuition. And you know that it's him because it wasn't your thought. You know it was smarter than you. You know how you are when God shows up. Ephesians 5:17, therefore do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Understand. In other words, don't just run before you understand what he's saying. Young preachers out there, listen to me. You don't run until you know what he wants you to do with what he gave you. You don't say anything until he's given you instruction to use it. And you can't preach it just because he gave it to you. He might be giving it to you just for you. Anyway, number three, he must be strengthened by God to resolve to carry it out. If God says it to you, should you want to do what he said? In Philippians chapter 2, verse 13, it says, for it is God who works in you. Who works in you? God. Both to will, that is, to be able to do something that you don't really want to do. Because if he asks you sometimes the things that God asks you to do, you don't want to do. Right? If you haven't had that experience yet, it's coming. Both to will and to work for his good pleasure. In other words, it's God that's going to work in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Who does the work? John 14 says this, it's not you that does the work, it's Jesus in you that does the work. Why is the adversary afraid of you? Because the Lord Jesus dwelleth in you, and you in him. Aren't you glad for that? Well, we ought to make the adversary, I mean, the gates of hell ought to be shaken and trembling right now, just at that revelation. Number four, he must be strengthened by God to execute it. In other words, you don't have the power. And as I read to you just then, for it is God who works in you both to will and to work his good pleasure. God is the one doing the work. God will not replace the believer in carrying out his will. He needs the believer. When the Holy Spirit came down at Pentecost, the Holy Spirit baptized about 130 people in the upper room. They went out and they preached the word of God fearlessly before the very same people that were crying out for the death and the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. But they had received something that gave them that boldness. See, it was the very Spirit of Christ. The Holy Spirit of God was poured out upon them. And they went out and they preached. And that afternoon, could you imagine this happening? That the Holy Spirit working in you, the boldness of the Holy Spirit in you, that afternoon, after he came on you, you went out and preached to everybody, told them everything. You know how you are. When bad news, you want to tell them all the bad news. Get off of CNN and start getting in the book, and you'll find out that there's some good news to actually proclaim out of your mouth, and that's the way it ought to be. You know, CBS ought to be ashamed of the stuff that they do on every morning of the week. You understand what I'm saying? These people out there, all they do is preach bad news. And what does that do? That sets you to expect bad things. God told us to expect good things, right? Holy things, true things, pure things. He told us to keep our mind on those things anyway. And you can't find any of that on CNN or CBS or ABC or, you know. And Fox News, as good as they are not as good as God. So I want to tell you that. And they're going to talk the same kind of trash. So, you know, when you go out there, you understand why God said, come out of the world and be a separate people. You see, you can't be in the world and of the world and be of God. You know, you're a creature different than that. He calls you to be something different. Old things pass away, behold, all things become new. Now that you've received Jesus Christ, you're an alien. Now look at your brothers and sisters and friends and that kind of thing and look at them. I thought you were an alien. Look at your eyes. They look like alien eyes. Anyway, so after a believer understands God's will, he should set his will to carry it out. If you know that it's the will of God, you ought to carry it out. Okay? After his will is set, he should claim the power of the Holy Spirit to carry it out practically. You don't try it without God's Spirit. You ask God to empower you to do what he has revealed to you. Don't do it on your own. You will fail. How many of you have ever failed at trying to do something for God? Okay. A believer must claim the power of the Holy Spirit because his will is too weak to act alone. Would you agree with that? It's true, isn't it? You can do nothing, Jesus said, without me. So, it's always the case that to will is present. This is Romans 7:18. To will is present with me, but to work out the good is not. In other words, I want to do right. Everybody in this room said amen to that. Nevertheless, but the power is not with me to do it. I have to inquire of God. When he shows me the will of God, then I have to ask God to empower me to do what I cannot do without him. He does the work. Okay? You don't fail when he does the work through you. You fail when you try to do it without him. That's another way, right? Okay, that's robbers and thieves according to Scripture. Therefore, the Holy Spirit is needed to strengthen our inner man so that we can practically obey God. First, God operates within us to make us willing. Okay? And next, God operates within us for his good pleasure. That's in Philippians 2:13. We just read that. God wills... reveals his will through our intuition. We saw that. If a believer's will is united to him, God will multiply strength to the believer and enable the believer to set his will according to the will of God and to carry it out. That's an important part. Listen to me now. When you know the truth, you have to say, Lord, I need your power to carry it out. And I'm setting my will now. I'm going to agree with you. I'm going to do what you have called me to do, and now I set my will, this is my will, to follow you and do your will. Unless you're in that, you know, that's what I'm saying. Half-hearted people, you wonder whether or not their whole heart is given to what God is calling them to do, right? You can't be half-hearted with God. What did he say about lukewarmness? It spew you out. And so you need to know, God needs to know who's on his side. God gives to them that are on his side. God blesses them that are on his side. God helps them to overcome all things who are on his side. So if you're not becoming the overcomer, you're wondering why bad things happen in your life, I've just shown you what's happening. You have not agreed with him. It's not that bad things won't happen in your life, but when you have God on your side, those things are subject to God. And they can be turned, because of your agreement with him, they can be turned into a testimony, because God will come through you and overcome all of those things for his name's sake. Okay? So, if a believer's will is united to him, God will multiply strength to the believer and enable the believer to set his will according to God's will and to carry it out. Okay? We're getting close to the end. I know some of you are getting antsy, but I want you to, these are very important things for you if you're going to become an overcomer, if you're really a genuine believer. These are necessary things for you to give God the power in your life. Stop taking power away from him. Stop taking choices away from him. He's not doing something that is against you. He will not withhold any good thing from them that love him and are called according to his purpose. God will want to reward those people who diligently seek him every day. God wants the believer to be one with his will. Yet he does not want to replace the children, his children in the application of his will. In other words, he wants you, he needs you to make choices. When I married Sheila Powell, we're married, right? Okay. We have a certificate that shows that. I got pictures that shows where the man stood before us, John Kilpatrick, and married us. We were the second people he married and the first one in the church, right? Anyway. And when she married me, she said she loved me. Now, how many of you know after you got married, there were tests? This is being recorded. Anyway. So when we got married, you know, I found out that, you know, two becoming one is not an instantaneous event. There is a period of time where old things are passing away and things are becoming new. There is a period where you learn about one another and you learn how to move as one together. And so, you see, that's what God's saying. I don't want you moving against me. I want you moving with me. God's purpose in creating and redeeming man is that man would become completely free in his will. In other words, when you make a choice, he says, count the cost. When you got married, husbands, was there a cost involved in marrying a wife and getting a woman in your life? Has it stopped? Women, when you married that man, did you find out that he wasn't the knight in shining armor that you thought he was, and that there were things that you just didn't like about after you married him? You didn't know this stuff before because they hid all that from you. See, they didn't want you to see all that they were, right? And so they hid that kind of, they put their best foot forward, you know, when you started dating them and all that kind of thing. And listen to me. It's not that it was a lie. They just didn't want you to know all the truth. Because you don't win somebody's affection if you know everything about them, because when you know everything about them, you know that they're humans and they make mistakes. And, and they're just like you. And you know you don't like you. Most of the time you can't stand yourself. So it takes a while for you to get to the place that you just have to settle down, that that's who they are and that's who you married, and that's, oh, come on now. Yes, you do. You see, because iron sharpens iron as the sparks fly upward. Yes, you do. And Sheila and I will be married 44 years this year. It is awesome, and, you know, it gets better as we get older. I just hope we got enough time to enjoy each other. You know, I keep waiting for the day that she'll retire so we can go buy that yacht and go floating off in some direction of Bahamas or the West. She's going, you know, you don't want to do that. Look, I've already looked some yachts. Those things are beautiful. Anyway, float like a bottle on top of all that water, right? Okay. I need to go on anyway. Through Sal, but let's go back. Is that where I am? Okay. God's purpose in creating and redeeming man, and that the man would become completely free in his will. Okay. Through the salvation accomplished by the Lord Jesus on the cross, believers today can freely choose to follow God's will. Freely. I don't want to extort people and make them. I wish I could. My God, this place would be full of people today if I could make people do right. It would be full of it because I don't want anybody to go to hell. But I have to rely on Him to be the power to do that. Can't do it. Okay. This is why many commandments in the New Testament, all of them pertaining to life and godliness, require the exercise of the will on the part of the believer to choose or to reject. Amen. You have to rely on God to choose or reject. If God wanted to eliminate the faculty of the will, would these commandments have any meaning? A spiritual believer is one who has the full power to exercise his own will. Is that right? He does. Okay. He should constantly choose God's will and reject Satan's will. Is that right? Should you constantly reject Satan? You should. And you should choose God. Okay. Here's some tough stuff. Although, many times he cannot tell what is from God and what's from Satan. Anybody ever had a problem there? Okay. Let me tell you what to do here. You need to listen up. Tune your ears in. Do not miss what I'm about to say to you. When you don't know whether or not it's God's will, you choose in your motivation to say to God and to the devil, I don't know if this is God's will or if it's Satan. But I choose God and I reject Satan. I reject his work. I reject all the stuff that he's putting before me. And Lord, I ask you to show me, clearly, show me. Do not move until he does. How many people have ever made a decision without God? How'd that work out for you? Okay. All right. Whew. I don't believe in luck. You know he... It's God in you that works and wills. He can say, although I do not know what belongs to God and what belongs to the devil, I will choose God and refuse the devil. Though he does not know what belongs to God, he can choose God in his motive. Choose everything that's of God. God, I choose you. I'm waiting on you. I'll do what you ask me to do. God, I choose you. I reject everything the devil's throwing at me. Even if it looks good, I won't choose it. I'll miss a lot of opportunities unless you open my eyes of understanding, because I'm only going to do those things that I know are pleasing to you. You have to set your will to follow God. That's what we're talking about, setting your will. He can adopt the attitude that he does not want anything that is from the devil, whatever it may be. Whatever comes upon him, he should choose or reject, whatever it is. You know how many times I've rejected things of God? Waiting. Knew it was in the Bible. But I didn't know if it was God's will for me at that moment. You see, God doesn't give pat answers. Do you know that His ways are past finding out? His thoughts are not your thoughts. His ways are not your ways. They're higher than your thoughts and higher than your ways. So you have to wait on Him. Nothing is more of a praise to God. Did you hear what I just said? Nothing is more than a praise to God than saying, Father, I'm here on your time. You put me here. All the time I've got left is in you. And I thank you that you'll lead me in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. I thank you, Lord, that now you're going to lead me because I have done what you have said. I have not leaned on my understanding. I am acknowledging you in all my ways. And you promised, Lord, that you would direct my steps. How many of you know that those feeble steps that we take when He asks us to do something are still being directed by Him? I don't want you to be confused. The devil comes to throw some sort of a cloud over all of this stuff. The things that I'm talking about, very important to an overcoming life in Christ. Well, whatever comes upon him, he should choose or reject. It does not matter if he does not know. He still must choose God's will. He can say, whenever I know God's will, I want it. Whenever I know God's will, I want it. What must you know? Did God tell you to move? Don't move. Did God tell you to do? Don't do. If he didn't tell you, don't do it. Even if it looks right. I've had people come to me, I thought this was, you know, I took this new job and I thought it was going to be, you know, what God was saying, and I've been praying for and that kind of stuff, and they go and it was heck to pay because they moved without God, without an understanding. I'm praying that every day today. You know, God, where do you want me to go? What do you want me to do? Okay? So, anyway, I will always choose God's will and reject Satan's will. Would you tell the Lord as a declaration? I will always choose God's will and reject Satan's will. Let me say this to you. There is something that, when I was saying this in pre-service, you want to hear God speak his word out loud. There are a lot of people that say things like this. I have an unspoken request. Well, you have an unspoken answer too. God didn't say anything there. You'll never find anywhere in the scripture, I have an unspoken request. It says, confess your faults, weaknesses to one another. Pray for one another. That you can be healed. Get direction. Sins forgiven. Whatever it is that's necessary. But when you don't learn that logio, the power of a spoken word, what did the Bible say? Your words have in them life and death. That's not just, you know, among men. This is among spiritual beings. Your words declare. Your words can bind or loose. You ever put anybody in bondage with your words? Remember now, there's power in what you say. You're saying what he says, there's power to overcome the adversary. When God puts a spirit of overcoming on you and you've got a word that comes from him, you've got an assurance that comes from him, take your next step. Somebody says, well, that step needs to be a step of faith. It is a step of faith, but you did it not in ignorance. You did it on the word, an acclamation that came from God himself. You didn't do it. You didn't step out without God. A lot of people make those huge errors in judgment because they're doing that very thing. You must wait on the Lord. I know that doesn't fare well with Western church, right? God expects us to wait until we have heard from him. In your waiting, give him thanks that he's already leading you and giving you victory. When there's an absence of an answer, give praise to the Lord. When you're doing that, then the Spirit of God comes upon you and He will lead you. He will give you His word. He promised that He would. And remember this, again, the gates of hell will not prevail against you. No matter what's coming at you, it will not come against you. Listen, He said, if there be people over here, 1,000 of them fall, He said, it won't be you. 10,000 over there, won't be you. When you're in the middle of a situation, the devil's trying to tell you, I won't take you down. You know, no, he's not. He knows he's a liar and he can't do anything because God's got you. He's not going to take you down. Okay? Anyway, by doing this, the Holy Spirit will work within you. He will strengthen you and that you'll be able to stand against the devil day by day, point by point, and that Satan will lose his power day by day. Aren't you glad that Satan has lost his power? Listen to me. When he said, I give you all power, Jesus now, I give you all power. Power is not authority. We already have authority. We have authority through the Word of God, but you must wait on the power. Who is the power? It's not you. It's Him. So you're waiting on Him, and He acts on His timing the way that He wants to act. So He said, I've given you all power over all the power of the adversary. All the power of the adversary. And come on with me. And nothing shall by any means harm you. Who said this? Jesus. He gave you all power. That's all the power. Who is the power? He's the power. There's no power but of God. And it says that He's given you Himself. Then God will gain one more faithful servant in a rebellious world. Right? Is that right? If we get to live 7 more days, and the Lord lets me come and preach to you, if I'm able to stand in this holy desk and preach next week, I'll be talking to you about self-rule. Wait a minute, is that humanism? You'll have to come in 7 days to find out. How many of you know that there are 9 gifts of the Spirit and one of them is called self-control? Okay. I want you to be able, listen, I'm talking kingdom stuff to you. I want you to be able to stand against every tide that the adversary has thrown. You know that he's trying to wear saints down in this last moment. You know that he's going to use spirits and people to try to do that to you. But you've got him on your side. You've got to know whose side you're on, right? So in the process of this, he has asked me to preach to you these things to get you prepared. He's coming back for a bride without spot or wrinkle. And I'm going to give you the tools as he gives them to me. I'm going to give them to you so that you can stand against the tide of the adversary and he will not be able to rail on you or overcome you. You will be able to overcome him. Nothing shall by any means harm you. And when the world is suffering and when they're starving, listen to me. He's just going to use you. They'll be running to your light. That's what he told us. A light is shining upon you, and then they will run to your light. You know what a moth does when the lights come on at night? It flies right toward the light. Even something that consumes everything will run toward your light. God will do that. And the day is coming. You'll see it. Amen. Let me pray. Father, I ask you, Lord, that the things that I've said, I know that was a lot of information, but I'm asking you, Heavenly Father, in Jesus' mighty name, right now, to overcome and help us to overcome all things that come against us. And Heavenly Father, that you'll cause us to be more than conquerors, Lord, of all of these things that try to prevail. And I'm asking you in Jesus' mighty name, Lord, that you empower your people with your Holy Spirit, and that we will learn how to be obedient, Lord God, even to a fault. That, Father, we won't move, we won't say, we won't do until we know that it's you. Father, I know that that's why Jesus was able to do all that he did, because he was completely surrendered to your will. Let us also be completely surrendered to your will, in Jesus' name. Amen.